So I have been taking on these issues, trying to help people understand issues related to race here in the United States, how we deal with critical race theory. And I early on in my political career, when I was beginning to get started in this, I just kind of had these ideas that I just tried to translate what my parents taught me into public policy. Well, I discovered over time that I was not alone in these things. And as I began to get into different circles, I began to connect with different individuals. And I began to find that there were more intellectuals, because honestly, when we would have discussions about race, you could find people that could, go on Fox News, or they could go on different news outlets and kind of talk anecdotally about things. But it was kind of tough to find actual scholarly works. And I love to read essays. I love to read lectures. So recently, my networks had put me in connection with the 1776 Unites Project, which is, in my opinion, like the standard that is kind of marching in as a rebuttal to the 1619 Project, which is the kind of the vehicle for the critical race theory, and it really has driven a lot of the racial sensitivity training that we've seen over the past few years. So I recently picked up a book. It's a fantastic book. I posted a picture of it on my Instagram, Torrey Snow WBAL, and talked a bit about it on my Facebook. If you don't follow our social media, it's a great opportunity to do so. But it's called Red, White, and Black: Rescuing American History from Revisionists and Race Hustlers. And I began to read this book. I actually had tried to find it. It was almost sold out. I managed to grab one of the last few copies. It's very difficult to find these days. I think there's going to be some more restocks coming. But the author, the editor of this book, Bob Woodson Sr., began to basically lay out everything in such an intellectual fashion that I was just extremely excited to hear it. And I reached out to the team and found that we were able to get Bob Woodson Sr. to join us for a brief discussion on his book and some of the issues of the day. Mr. Woodson, it is such an honor to have you on the program. Thank you so much for being part of our discussion. I just want to, I know your time is precious. I want to get right into it. When you use the term rescuing American history from revisionists and race hustlers, why did you pick those terms, revisionists and race hustlers? What are the significance of those?
It's significant to just be very clear and not abstract, because that's what the 1619 Project is. It's kind of unclear and abstract. So I wanted to make it plain. I'm a veteran of the civil rights movement. I've been led demonstrations in the 60s. And so I was there. I know what segregation is like. And I really wanted to confront some of the lies and misconceptions that were being advertised as history of the country. Fundamentally, what the people who authored that report said is that a lot of the problems facing large numbers of low-income blacks today, out-of-wedlock birth, violence, economic distress, are all a result of legacy of slavery and Jim Crow. And therefore, the only answer is for white America to provide reparations to blacks. Well, we wanted to confront that not with a counter-argument, but with data, also with inspirational stories. So we went back with our scholars, and we looked at the period even after slavery, and what did blacks do? How did they respond to slavery and oppression? Was it just to be cower in the corner and be a victim? No. When we were denied access to hotels, we built our own. Chicago had 731 black-owned businesses in 1929, $100 million in real estate assets. We even in Baltimore, in 1868, when blacks were fired from the docks, we didn't march on Washington demanding jobs, peace, and freedom. We established our own railroad, the Chesapeake, Maine Dry Dock and Railroad Company, and successfully operated a railroad from Maine to from Baltimore to Maine, and hired 1,000 people, including some whites. So what we did in this book is blacks have a rich history of prospering even in the face of oppression. And so we wanted to lay all of this out for everyone, and the response has been amazing.
It doesn't surprise me. Mr. Woodson, one thing that you mentioned is that we need to desegregate poverty. And that's a recurring theme throughout the book and many of the matters of 1776 unites. Why is it so important that we desegregate poverty?
Because unfortunately, we associate poverty with violence. And poverty has never been associated with aberrant behavior. And I give examples in the book of 1930 to 1940 when racism was enshrined in law and the unemployment rate in the black community during the Depression was 40%. It was 25% for whites. We have the highest marriage rate of any group in society. And because of our Christian faith and belief in self-determination, elderly people could walk safely in their neighborhoods without fear of being assaulted by their children. And we have five major black high schools, one in Baltimore, Dunbar High, in Washington, that in 1920, they were overcrowded, used textbooks, half the budget of white schools. Every one of those all-black schools tested higher than all of the white schools in Baltimore, New York, Washington, Atlanta, and New Orleans. So we provide evidence that when whites were at their worst, we were at our best. And the question is, if during segregation, we could outperform even white schools and we can build businesses, out of wedlock birth was under 12%. If we were able to accomplish these things in the face of segregation, the question is, why are black children failing in systems run by their own people today? Systems Wow. that have been for the last 50 years. So these are very troubling questions for people to have to confront, because then they can just retire and say, oh, it's just institutional racism. I don't even know what that is.
We're speaking with Bob Woodson from 1776 Unites and the author of Red, White, and Black, Rescuing American History from Revisionists and Race Hustlers. Here in Baltimore City, we do find that there is economic depression, there's poor education, there's many, many challenges in Baltimore City. What advice would you have for city leaders like Mayor Scott and the city council leaders in getting Baltimore City back on track?
The first thing I would do is abandon this whole racial defense that I keep hearing from President Biden, the systemic racism. I recommend that Black America stop complaining about white people for 1 year and begin to look back in some of the essays and say, if black children and teachers could inspire and in the face of oppression, what lessons can we learn from the past that we can apply today? There are islands of excellence even today where black communities are safe, where black community has been restored. Right up the road in Somerset, New Jersey, Pastor Buster Sorries at First Baptist Church of Lincoln Gardens. His church inspired the revitalization of an entire community. Businesses are moving in. Public housing is safe. So there are models of how church leaders have used economic and social strategies that were effective in the past, how they have applied them to in today's place. So there are some models around. So I would suggest that Baltimore leaders, you know, get off the race grievance bandwagon and begin to come together and confront the enemy within to say what lessons can we learn from what we used to do when we were under conditions that are far worse than they are, so we can apply some of those valuable lessons today.
Mr. Woodson, your book, Red, White, and Black, is very, very popular. It's hard to keep in stock. Why do you think people are buying this book so quickly? And what do you think your book offers that people are just dying to read?
All the people have been offered right now with 69 is anger or looking for a villain to blame. What we're offering, people are desperate for solutions. They want to know what victories are possible, not injuries to be avoided. And so the reason that they're turning to our books, we wanted to know, one of our scholars looked at the records, he looked at the records of six plantations immediately after slavery and found that 75% of black slave families had a man and a woman raising children. And for a century, we maintain two-parent households. As someone said, one country, one God, two parents.
Well, Mr. Woodson, I want to thank you so much for the work that you're doing, the thought leadership that you're providing, and for joining our program today. Thank you for the hard work that you and your scholars at 1717 Unites are bringing to the discussion. Please have a safe weekend. And again, thank you for your contributions to this discussion.
And thank you for giving us the chance to share it.
That was Bob Woodson, who is the editor and author of Red, White, and Black, Rescuing American History from Revisionists and Race Hustlers. So much meat in that discussion. I mean, there was just examples of where Baltimore City can be. And by the way, I'm reading this book. I'm going through it. I couldn't agree more. I do believe that if someone like Mayor Scott, if someone like Baltimore City State's Attorney Marilyn Mosby and these other leaders in Baltimore City, I think if they would just take some time with an open mind, read this book, understand what is capable, Baltimore City can be the economic engine of the Eastern Seaboard. We have the ability to do so, but we need to put our egos aside and start looking at what is actually going to work for our communities. We're going to talk more about this. I want to get your reactions to our guest. Text the Metro Bath and Tile text line 410-467-9225. I'm Torrey Snow, WVAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.